Am I visible?
Yeah, you are visible.
I see two things that we need to check before we start off on a journey. Great. So, what I'll do is first I'll share my screen so that we have the presentation in the background, and maybe then I'll start. So, window. Present now. Entire screen, then I'll put into the presentation. Okay, is the presentation visible now?
No. You have to open PPT and then do present now. It just now. What is this? Okay.
So this is the
There is an icon present now, Akshay, at the end, down right.
Yes, I am using that present now icon.
And then you use present a window.
Okay,
And then you
great.
select your PPT.
I have presented building professionalism. This is the right. Thank you.
Now it's coming.
It's coming,
Yeah,
so
okay. Now it's clearly visible. You just have to play the slide.
okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fine. So to start with, good morning to everyone. Some of you I must be meeting for the second or third time, I guess. And this time the topic that I am taking is building professionalism. Now, talking of professionalism, there is a lot of material that is available, and there are a lot of things that we can talk about in being professional. But when it comes to how do we build professionalism, it becomes a truly Herculean task as to how do we get into getting a roadmap, a pathway as to how we can build upon and reach greater professionalism. So in the presentation that follows, what I have tried is I have tried to try take approach which starts from me as to how do I get into building that professionalism. It starts from looking inward within me and then looking outside as to what I can do to align myself with the outside world. That is the preset to the entire presentation that I am sharing with you all. So let me understand what is professionalism. It is a two-way communication, Nikhat ma'am.
निखत में निखत में
Am I audible? Can anyone please give me a feedback?
Yes,
yes.
Okay. So it's a two-way communication. I can keep asking questions in between and somebody can answer. Yeah. Would
Yeah,
that
they can
run
unmute and
your
they can
PPT, please?
answer you.
Okay. So let's start having a conversation on what is professionalism. Let me ask it this way. Is it our appearance, a good grooming, neatness, or the demeanor that people show at workplace or the work environment? Is that professionalism? Or maybe we say that it is the expertise and the technical skills, the knowledge that we carry, the expertise that we carry, that is professionalism. Is it the conduct of a person at a workplace or work environment? I mean, coming with the latest scenario. It is this conduct of a person in the work environment that is attributed to his attitude and displayed behavior. That is professionalism. Which one of this would you choose?
participants can unmute and answer, or if they want, they can drop in chat box. Yes, Praveen sir.
I'm sorry, I could not hear the question properly.
Okay, I'll ask it again. Am I audible clearly?
Yes.
Fine. So then my question is, see, professionalism is a word that has got a lot of understanding in the daily parlance. And people understand differently and relate to it differently. So what I'm trying to do out here is, first, let us all be on the same platform of understanding what we are going to talk about in professionalism. I have displayed three questions. The question first is it a set of appearance, grooming and demeanor that a person carries in the workplace or work environment?
Yes.
The expertise that a person carries could be technical skills, could be knowledge, could be experience. Or third option is it the conduct of a person at a workplace or work environment which is attributed to his attitude and displayed behaviors?
All the above. It's a combination of all.
It's a combination of all. Wonderful, wonderful. Can I have your name, please?
Yeah, I'm Praveen Gupta.
Praveen, thank you so much, Praveen. Praveen, you, as you rightly said, it's a combination of all three. So which part should we be focusing most on right now to begin with?
The last thing.
Professionalism. What should we be focusing on right to begin with?
To be the appearance.
Okay. And why so, Praveenji?
Because visual aspect gives the first impact. When we open our mouth, then only the impacts are perceived or experienced.
To an extent, yes. I'll request to park this thought for some time.
Okay.
Because the way we are going to think, maybe we are going to dive a little deeper into it.
Hmm.
Other than Praveenji, is there anyone else who would like to share
his something systematically, sir? To do something systematically in a proper way.
To do something systematically in the process, in the profession, is professionalism. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. You are
things
correct.
Things can be done anyway. Mm-hmm. But when I say I'm doing in a professional way, when we have that work has to be done in this particular way and I follow that particular system, then
okay.
It is professionalism.
Great. So when you are talking about a particular system, you are talking about the standards and the rules that are there in the profession that you are working with.
Yeah.
These standards can vary from profession to profession.
Profession to profession and work to work.
Work
job
to work.
Job.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Great. Again, see, we have got a one more view, which is a great thought. Thank you. Thank you so much. Can I have somebody else also sharing his thought? So rather than keeping it a monologue, a one-way discussion, I would, a person who always loves to have a two-way communication, you know, keep interacting. Because once you start sharing your thoughts, it becomes easy for me to get into driving as to where I want to go. And it becomes more interesting also. So may I request other people also to unmute and maybe share one by one? Two or three more sharings if I can have. It appears that it is only V3 that we are discussing.
No, I just got in. I may know what you're expecting us to say. I just.
Okay, may I have your name, please?
I'm a Leo Raju. Yeah.
Mr. Raju, if I may call you, we are discussing professionalism.
Yeah.
And I have put up a set of questions as to, you know, which is visible on the slide.
No, I'm not able to see the questions. I can see only the. Building professionalism, that is what the roadmap to great success. That's
what
I'm
saying.
Actually, you have to play this slide. It is you have not played this slide, and the slide is on the first slide only.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I'm not able to get it. Yes.
Oh, thank you. Is it now? What is professional?
No, you have to present again. You have stopped presenting.
Okay, I'll get back at it again. Oh my. Okay, so I'm saying present now, window. I go back to. No. First, I have to start presenting. Right, and then. So when I'm using start presenting,
yeah, now it is loading.
Okay. But it is not the slide that I am presenting.
Yeah, but you have shared the screen, your desktop. Okay. Instead of desktop, you just have to share your PPT.
Okay. So first I'll have to stop presenting.
And share this. You have to stop this. Stop sharing.
Stop sharing. Okay, stop presenting. Now I'll have to first
go to present now.
Go to present now.
Your PPT is open, right, Akshay?
Right, my PPT is open.
Okay, then go to present now.
Present now.
Then select that PPT.
Now I have selected the building professional PPT.
And then share it.
So it is showing me.
Yes, we can see your PPT, Akshay, but now just you play this slide.
Okay.
The second slide, which is being shown.
Yes, yes.
No, let him play the slide. No, it is in the PPT. Yes.
Okay.
Kindly press F5 so that it would be run.
F5. Is it now running?
Slide is in presentation mode only, it is not playing. Press F5, Akshay. It will run. F5 is a shortcut for this.
It is saying stop sharing.
Okay. No problem. I think there's some technical problem. Sir, you can go on second slide then.
I'll go it this way. Second slide.
Akshay, you can do one thing. Share your PPT. I will share it from here.
I'll mail the PPT to you.
Yeah.
Okay. Just give me.
I'll share it from you.
Attaching the PPT, just give me a second. The PPT is on the stop. I have mailed it to you, madam.
Yeah, I'll check.
So I'll stop presenting.
You can stop presenting. You have mailed me on my official mail ID, right?
Yes, I have mailed you on your official mail ID.
Okay, wait.
Okay. So meanwhile, I can just have a conversation like this with the second slide on. So could this be because of a low bandwidth, just to understand?
Could be because this is a technical problem. Can you see the screen?
Yes, I can see it.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it okay?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
So we can move on to the second slide. You will be able to operate it only, na?
Yeah, you just have to tell me. I'll mute myself and then you just have to tell me to next slide. Move to next slide.
Fine. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay, now this is the slide that I was talking about. And I was trying to bring in your thought process as to what is professionalism. And as I said in the start, at the start of the program, that professionalism is a word that has been taken and understood very differently by different people in different walks of life. So the idea out here is to have a common understanding as to what is professionalism and how do we proceed to build professionalism. So as Mr. Praveen said, the first thing that we need to start, it is a combination of all three. And to start building professionalism, we should first focus on our appearance, grooming, neatness. That is his thought process. And there was a second input where a ma'am said it is more like aligning ourselves to the system that are there in the organization. And these systems could be different for different organizations. That is her thought process. Both are valid thought processes. I am looking at more input as to what is professionalism to you and how do you see that building up? Yes, Mr. Raju, you were there. Mr. Leo Raju, am I audible?
Sorry, I was in the call. Okay, sir. Okay.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, so this is the slide. Could you get into what discussion that I've had?
Yeah, it's about the last one. Is the kind of person that workplace, work environment, attribute is attitude and displayed behaviors. A certain number of qualities you possess when you face the professional environment. It deals with the behavior, attitude, your whole kind of internal setup, how you react to the outside environment in a more professional, smooth way to carry out any meaningful functions. That's what I feel.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Raju, because you have hit the nail on the head. We say so all three, definitely it is all three, but something which is comes out to be the most important thing where we can start with is the third one, where we see as to how do we conduct ourselves in the workplace and work environment. And this output of our is something that, have gone through the nurturing and what has been given to us. Do we understand our? Are we able to align ourselves to the profession that we are working in? Do we understand what is expected in the profession? All things combined together is what goes on to building the professionalism. Yeah, can we move on to the third slide, ma'am? So how it is being defined out here is, we need to understand who we are, what is our inner character. Because as a resultant of this inner character, we'll have a set of behaviors that will be exhibited on our day-to-day life in could be a work profession, could be even non-work profession environment. And because of these behaviors that we are exhibiting, our image is perceived by the people around us. And when all this is aligned with the set of standards and rules that are expected of an individual for a satisfactory work performance, that produces a true professionalism. That is how I have summed the entire definition of professionalism. Are we all on the same page of understanding? If you have a question, you will please ask a question out here. Mr. Raju, you are on unmute. Are you looking at asking something?
No.
Okay. Anyone else who has a question on this page? Okay. So I move forward with an understanding that this particular portion we are together till here. Now let's move on to the next part and see. Ma'am, can I have a next slide, please? So why is it important? The importance can be understood. Importance of building professionals can be understood from this, where a survey was conducted by NACE. Now NACE is a National Association of Colleges and Employees of a US based out of Pennsylvania. Now they say professionalism and ethics top the list of workplace competencies, with more than 97% respondents identifying it as absolutely essential for new college hires. This was done for the college students who were doing their final year and coming out to join the profession, and the respondents were the corporate people. Now, when such a huge bent of people is there for one particular thing, which is professional ethics, we need to really focus hard on this as to how do we build it going forward. May I please go to the next slide, ma'am? So roadmap to building professionalism, here comes when I say inside out approach. Out here I'm talking about, we need to first see as to there is a work environment which has got a standard set of rules, standards which are to be followed, and there is a person, a profession who is working in that environment. Now this person or a profession is a output of his inner characters, the behaviors that he displayed, and the image that is perceived by the people around us. So now these three wheels in the environment is what we are going to look at to building professionalism. Ma'am, can I move to the next slide, please? So how do we understand ourselves? Maybe some of you might have gone through some psychometric test and got yourself self-personality and understood in a very descriptive way. But this is one of the oldest and one of the most simplistic way of understanding self, which is DISC, a psychometric tool, which was done by Mr. Moulton. It's formed basis of a lot of psychometric tests that are there prevalent in present world, be it a number of psychometric tests that are there. People have gone into moving into from four personality types to 16, 16 to 32, but they are basically doing into micro understanding of the human nature, human personality. Out here, understanding self comes from a perspective that how do I understand myself in these four quadrants? And it's a very simple method to understand, and how it is related to professional, that I'll also come in a second part. So first part, the four aspects, the four quadrant, the matrix that comes out is there is a set of people who are action oriented, who feel themselves to be more in control of the situation that are around them. And there is a set of people who perceive themselves to be less powerful than the environment around them, and therefore they look for stability. So that makes one vertical division, top and bottom. And then there is a set of people who are more people oriented. They would not want to upset the people around them. And there is a set of people who are more task oriented, who are more focused on getting the task done, because that is that how they are. So based on these four things, there comes out to be four type of people, personalities basically. A person could be a mixture of all four, all two, two or one. That is one thing that we can observe, or we can go through a psychometric test. But how these personalities come out in terms of behavior is what we are going to be the area of focus. So taking the D symbol first, D stands for dominance out here. Basically, this personality type is task oriented, more dominating in nature. It's direct in conversation. They are good decision, very prompt decision maker. So when you see them around, mixing with people, you will see them always in a bit of hurry. They would project themselves to be under a lot of workload. their pace of conversation, their walking style would be fast. Even their conversation would be very direct, at times bordering to be rude. You know, they could blast somebody without minding as to whosoever is around them. But what is their focus is, are they achieving the results? So some of the common words that they speak is cut short the, you know, things around, give me what is the bottom line, talk to me in terms of how is going to be the result, don't give me all those theories, give me direct, answer me directly, give me short answer. These are type of conversation that come around with people who are typically high on D. But as I said, people are combinations. So when we observe ourselves, we'll have to understand as to what kind of dominant or predominant behavior are we displaying during our interaction with other people. Coming on to the I part, I is basically, influence. This influence basically is the personality type that are more people oriented. To them, respecting people and getting respect or importance from people is more important. They are flamboyant, they love bright colors. They cannot have a direct conversation. They like to build upon first small conversations, know about family, talk about their family, talk about big visions, talk about something that is of interest to you or to the other person. So they are basically relationship oriented. They are talkative. They could be bordering to be garrulous. They are impulsive. They jump onto because to them, the relationship matters most. So at times their decision making is also guided by this principle. And in their behavior, you will see that when they are with people around them, they'll be, you know, that live wire in the conversation. What you say in the party, if you see, they'll be the people who would be most sought after. In office, there'll be people under this kind of a personality would be one who would be friendly with everyone. People, everyone around would love this kind of a guy. And then moving on to the third, which is S, which is stands for steadiness. Now, this kind of a personality is, although it is people oriented, but is more of somebody who believes in keeping everyone happy around by not getting into direct conflict, by avoiding the conflict, by avoiding to taking decision, by being a good worker. You know, they are excellent in terms of taking orders and executing. Their conversation style is very steady. They'll listen, very good listeners. They'll talk, very good advice givers. They connect beautifully. Only thing is their stress factor is when you ask them to lead or take decisions, they might get a bit ruffled and then they withdraw into their own shell. And then coming on to the last, which is C, which is conscientious, what we call, which is a kind of personality that is more data oriented. When I say data oriented, they are logical in their thought process. They are data driven. They reason it out. They do a lot of analyzing. They do a lot of calculation and tend to be bordering on introversion, where they respect their own personal space a lot. So they don't like people having a lot of conversation. So they come out as people who would be giving you data and giving you a direct conversation. And at times that could look like to be rude. So now, talking about these different four personality types, what I want is for you all to sit back, think about yourself. You could be falling as a combination of two or three, but there would be definitely one predominant style which you can identify with yourself. Would you like to do this out here? Just now, as a process of taking the conversation further, so that we can get into how does it connect to the professionalism. Waiting for the answer.
C. See, no data is coming. So C is, people are feeling a bit reluctant to participate this way to be analyzed, probably. This is one of the reading I'm getting from no response.
See, it could be two ways. One, it is a set of people are highly in the C category, and therefore they are bordering introversion. Or it could be the other way around, where the nuances of or the failures of online sessions. I don't see you. You don't see me. You see me, and I don't know how much interaction is happening. But
I put my camera on, no issues.
Thank you so much. Actually, you are the most conversant participant, and I'm happy to have you in this session. Otherwise, this would have been a one-way conversation, which I would have died right in midway.
Okay, no issues. I have put on my camera, though I'm not camera ready at this moment. I'm taking the liberty to be a participant.
Thank you so much, Mr. Krohn. So nice to see you talking to faces. Anybody else would also like to join in this way, please?
Just a moment. Yes. Am I visible now?
Yeah, you are very much visible. Thank you so
much. Same question which you keep asking.
Yeah. So, what do you perceive yourself for? Are you... four categories. Where do you see yourself?
I would prefer to keep myself like a clean slate.
And this statement of yours puts you in more of a S category.
Okay.
Why? Because your thought process is, okay, I don't want to unruffle anyone. I want to be good to everyone. I am focused on people around me and to the person that I am talking to. And let's see how things progress.
That's true.
And that is where I see identify you to be more of an S personality, just from a small conversation that we are having. Can I have some more conversations like this?
So can I switch off my camera now?
Yeah, you may, please.
Yeah. That saves bandwidth.
Yeah, thank you. So I can read out some name. Yeah, Lakshmi ma'am.
Stability, sir. I prefer, I would be a person with a democratic and good listener and supportive characteristics. That is okay. My candidate okay. Today.
Wonderful. I guess when I'm talking to faculties, most of you would come out to be in this category.
Yes, sir.
Academicians, you strive for excellence. You strive for perfection. So that becomes your thought process. As faculties, you maintain good relationship with your peers and you maintain focus on the relationship with the students. You are always supportive and you see to it that whatever you are doing is almost to perfection or is excellent. So maybe the profession has carved out a personality type in you. Are you getting me? Do I relate to it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir. Obviously, we are imbibing the same type of characteristics to two students. So automatically, we are also trained ourselves like that. So that become our identity. That is what I... especially teaching profession that involves this type of characteristics to a teacher.
Perfect. Point taken. Thank you so much, Lakshmi.
Thank you, sir.
Shahrukh, sir, I can see the name of Mr. Muhammad, Dr. Muhammad Idris, sir, ma'am, Mr. Raju. Okay, now the moment I start calling out name, I see a lot of people leaving the classroom, so I better not call out names. That is what the signal comes to me. Fair enough. Now, how does it relate to professionalism? See, what happens? These are what our inner characteristics are. And based on this, what my natural behavior would be. But a person, people who are around me, they might be of a different attribute. And that could not be matching to the environment around me. Say, suppose I take this, S personality type, who is a good listener, a democratic, supportive person, and put him into a leadership role somewhere, maybe say in your college, if I put you in say placement cell or maybe marketing cell, then you will have to make an effort to bring in changes in your behavior to be more outgoing, to be more decision-making, to be more, more persuasive with the people. Am I making sense?
Yes, sure, you're making sense, because I was placement head, I was like head of department, like earlier time, but then I saw that the actions probably sometimes they lead to results, sometimes they don't lead to results. So the perceptions which are created are varied. And then I moved on to stability, like not only as a professor and doing my teaching and research. That's so this is where I switched. I agree.
Thank you so much, Praveenji, for sharing your experience, because that is what builds up the credibility of the thought process. So out here, what we see is being in the placement cell, you were put under some kind of a stress because that was not your natural style. And to minimize that stress, you had only two options, either to change yourself and come out as a more I kind of person with a bit of D, where you go out, meet people, have a small talk, good relationship, excellent relationship, spend time on that, at times be pushy, persuasive. And since you found that to be stressful, maybe you came back to the core profession of being a faculty. So that is where I'm coming to. The first thing to building professionalism is understanding myself, my traits, my inner characters, and the expectation that the work environment has from me in that particular role. Until unless I am able to bring that synergy, align both the things, all the topics that are going to be covered as to what comes under professionalism could be, the demeanor, the handling, the conversation, the communication, the resilience, would only be topics in the sense of interest of knowledge. It will not go to the application level. For me to apply the learning that we are having a discussion out here, I need to first understand myself, assess myself, and see to where the gap lies and how do I move forward in aligning myself to the work environment, the standards, the job that I am in.
I have one clarification, sir. Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Rajesh.
As far as this application is concerned, though we talk about so much of theory and all the stuff about professionalism, all those things, but an element of outside people's opinions and all, we value much. So I switch off mentally what others think about me, what others value me or not. I just mentally switch off. So I do my own convictions, whatever I convinced with, I do it irrespective of whatever others think about. That way I feel I am better in the professional qualities implementing application part. When I switch off others' opinion, what others, that alone I switch off. I act on my own independent thinking, whatever the good or bad, but I act on whatever knowledge I have, I can able to implement a bit. If I don't consider what people think around me, I'll mentally switch off and the situation happening around. So that way I'm getting benefited. So how do you feel about it?
Right, sir. So you are more of a C person. Conversation, what I am getting, you have got your own system and logic in place.
Yes.
You seldom want anyone to come into your space because you feel that is your private space. That is your personality time.
Yes.
Coming from this small conversation that I am having with you. Now,
sir, what
subscribe
I feel is,
ma'am, Revati ma'am, just give me a second. Let me first complete Mr. Raju's conversation, then I'll come to you. So now, sir, what happens with this thought in mind in your profession as a faculty? You could also be perceived, I'm talking about the perceptions, by the students or other faculties as somebody who is slightly reserved, who doesn't like to, you know, get into a contribution, cooperation kind of a scenario. So let him be and let us maintain that space. Then that team's energy is not coming up. That could be a gap. And although we might be known that we have to be cooperative, we have to work in a team, we have to be collaborative, we have to be a problem solver, all this will remain just the knowledge part. Would be difficult to apply if I don't overcome my inner characteristics, align it to the job that I'm in. Are you getting me, Mr. Raju?
Yes, sir.
So I am just sowing the seeds of thinking. Start thinking, maybe then things will become clearer as we move forward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes,
so
sir.
Now can I move to Revati ma'am? Raju sir, with your permission?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Revati ma'am.
Yes, sir. From what I have experienced and what I have been seeing in for a long time as a profession, in my profession, I feel that sometimes we need to be task-oriented rather than people-oriented. Because I've seen people who are people-oriented, as a leader, they are not successful because most of them take advantage of that person. They always create a sympathy on them, and they somehow try to avoid doing work, and they misuse the leadership of the other person. That is, those who are people oriented, more of people oriented, I feel they are not really successful as a leader.
Why do you feel that, ma'am? Because as a leader, you have to work with people around you only.
People around, but I have seen, I don't want to mention few names, but I have seen people who are more people oriented rather than task oriented. They are unable to get the task done in time because the people around them misuse them.
Madam wants to convey that if you you cannot do administration if you want to maintain your relationship, and that's what madam is trying to convey. If you are really busy in maintaining relationship,
little blending can be there. I can hear to them, but always if they know that I'm going to give a positive response to them, at times I'm misused. They put things where I feel sympathy on them and I don't give that work to them. And somehow they avoid the work being done.
So yeah. I'll clear your doubt.
Sorry, actually.
Yeah, Ravindji, please.
This is the reason I left those roles.
Leaving the job, Ravindji, leaving that role. What is coming from? See, when you are talking more of people oriented or more of task oriented, you are already understanding that there is a mix of all the four types or three types or two types. It is just not one particular display of behaviors. Definitely, if somebody is more, when you say is predominantly I type and is in an administrative role and understanding the impact of not being task oriented, his team would always be on a picnic.
Right.
The relationship, they'll be going out, they'll be having all kind of conversations and fantastic family relations. But when it comes to task, they won't. The results will not be there. And the reason for that would be that we have to understand that as a person, if I am that, I have to control that and shift toward being task oriented, because it's a flexibility that I bring in display of behaviors that bring better result.
Correct. That's true. Basically,
it should be a blend of both, actually. It should be a blend of both. Task oriented and people.
Not only blend of both, ma'am. As a evolved person who understand himself, my you know, moving ahead would come, how much am I able to flex my style? At times, I would have to be more of a, you know, dominating or decision-making direct person, which is D-type. At times, I'll have to be more of a I person. At times, I would have to be the role of a S person. And there could be times, situations where I have to be more of a C person. Depending on how do I understand and observe people around me and identify their personality trait. That's see, understand also apart.
Actually, ideal leader, he can balance both the task and people.
Absolutely, absolutely.
They would not bother about the people's saying. Definitely, there will be there. Things will be there. But we have to take the, handle the situation in a right way. That's all.
So, they will not
however bother. However, we have to face the people. However, we have to complete the task. Both are our domains. So, we have to balance between. We ought to do.
Absolutely. So the leader will not bother about what people say. The leader would value the relationship with the people and still be task oriented. Not task oriented, I cannot be people oriented. I can be. I have to choose situations. I have to communicate that way. It is all about creating the perception around me by knowing myself first and where I have to make an effort. So, are you getting me, Revati ma'am and Lakshmi ma'am?
Yes, sir.
I am also getting, sir.
Praveen ji.
because I'll second your this statement by saying whenever I get into conversation, whether asking question or anything, I always look at the face of Nikhat ma'am.
So, ma'am, do you have anything to say on this?
What should I say on this?
See, that is where the beauty of this conversation lies. I tell you, in most of the programs, although I am taking only a very small discussion on this as per the time permission, when I do this program for an entire day or two, people after finishing of this particular module, they get into a habit of observing people and identifying as to whether he is D, he is I, he is S, he is C. No, and this kind of a conversation becomes a common lingo. Aray, ye to S tha. Oh, this is, he's more like a D, you know. This conversation starts happening between the people who are the participants. Reason being, the takeaway from is to move on, getting work done, to build relationship, to have a conflict-free or less conflict conversations. It is always good to flex my style to the other person's style. See, if I'm talking to somebody like who is D or maybe high D, rather than getting into small conversations and being friendly to him, if I only talk of the result that is going to be delivered, he'll be more interested to the point. And my conversation will finish off in a small and meaningful way. Whereas if I am talking to a person who is I, and if I go and give him a direct conversation as to this is how I'm going to do the work and result is going to be carried this way, he'll say, what kind of a professional or a reserved person or person who is so cold? He'll have his own mindset. So dealing with people around me and creating my image as I am a contributor, I am somebody who's taking people around with me in my job, I have to be able to understand myself and flex my style accordingly. That is the entire purpose of this discussion. Yeah, ma'am? Sir? Can I move forward now?
Nikhat ma'am is the right person to ask.
Very good afternoon, sir. I want to just share something with you.
Sure, sir. Most welcome, please.
I have listened to the communication of some of the faculties and expert. I have observed that they are just talking about the leadership, right, sir? As a dean of the computer science, I just want to say something regarding this and just express some experience that I have.
Sure, please do.
as a leader, I think you have to digest the pressure that we have from the management actually. Whatever the things that just we are receiving directly from the manager, whether it is strict instructions or some level of instructions are there that we need to pass from the our junior also. So as a leader, you have to filter whatever the instructions that we are receiving, and we just convert it into some politely manner, and then we have to convert it to our junior. I think this is what I'm doing right now from this position. So sir, my question is that, is there any specific kinds of techniques that how we can digest the such kinds of pressure?
Okay, so you are not digressing from the topic and taking me on to a different topic of leadership dwell upon, but Nikhil ma'am will have to then double my time.
Sure, so we are going to have a next slot in March again, so I'm definitely going to talk to you on this.
Fair enough. So with your permission, Dr. Idris sir, I would keep this question for that particular session, because out here we are not only talking of leadership, we are talking about understanding myself and aligning myself to the work culture, environment and people around me. Leadership, it could be any role, it could be other than being into profession of being a faculty or academics, could be any profession, could be army, could be being a doctor, could be being a sales guy. Any profession has got its own set of environment which expects certain behaviors to be exhibited by a person, and this person is a mix of all the set of behaviors that he has gone through in part of being nurtured, and something that have come to him by nature. This nature and nurture is what a person has to look into honing himself better and aligning to the work environment. That is what we are talking about out here. Right, sir? Okay. So, with your permission, ma'am, I have now moved on to the next slide, which, since we have understood ourselves, now we are going to talk about the topics or the knowledge that is going to help us to align to the environment, to become a better professional, or building our professionalism. That is what we are going to talk about. And what I have is, I have identified these 10-12 points which I am going to discuss. Some of this could be directly related to your profession, some of this could be indirectly related, but definitely they all would be having some or the other relevance to the work environment. Now, first is coming to the productiveness. So how do we see productiveness? What do we mean by productiveness? My question to all of you, anyone can answer.
Yeah, as usual, I'm again coming back.
So, I bless my staff for having you in the session, sir.
So, productiveness is basically what we are supposed to do in terms of the profession. Like in academics, we are supposed to teach, so we should be able to teach well, and if we are supposed to do research, then we should be able to do good research, which can be applied or fundamental, whichever way it is.
Fantastic. Productiveness talks about the output criteria. What are the output criteria of your profession? And can I move to the next slide, please? Of the few things comes to productivity, the first and foremost that is important to output is how punctual quality. As stated out here, is basically taken from the IT sector, where the login and logout hours are measured by biometrics, and they say even a 5 minute early leaving totals out to 30 hours of work time in a year. And in IT profession, as you all know, people are paid by per hour basis. In any profession, in our profession, being a faculty also, if you see, the punctuality is not only my classes, punctuality is also of the timelines that I am following for myself, work and my home, because that is what is going to create further the topics that I'm going to talk about, work-life balance and stress life and all that. Punctuality is being aware of the that is ticking around me. Time is not stopping. Am I punctually following? That is what I'm talking about here in terms of. Next slide, ma'am. I'll go slightly faster now. And wherever you have a question, please raise your hand or you can unmute and ask a question. Second important pillar in productiveness that I think is attendance, which obviously applies to a very little profession, because I see professors or faculty absolutely, almost 90 attendance. But in other professions, sometimes basically where people have field work, they have all reason to show up on the work because they are focused more on the result. But coming back to the profession of being a faculty also, we are driven more by the syllabus, and we see that the syllabus is being covered, my dashboard says, the papers are being written and the tasks are being meant. But if at all, attendance, my opportunity of interaction with my people and staff around me is I am losing on productiveness. That is what the bottom line outline. So it says that 80% of success showing up. That is what the actor Woody Allen said. You have to be there. Don't find reason. One of the most important qualities an employee can display is dependability. And that dependability comes from how I am expected to be there and I am there required. And the main factor out there is attendance. Attendance is usually the top rank when it comes to an employee's performance and is necessary for growth. That is what attendance talks about. Ma'am, can I move to the next slide, please? Coming to the important aspect of communication, professionalism. So, ma'am, can I have this slide as blank? I would like to have conversation. B, control B. Press control and B. Okay, so the slide is not there. Now I want to have your inputs. When we are talking about verbal communication, what are those things that you keep in mind as to be wary of?
Sir, it depends on the person with whom we are communicating.
Okay.
In a professional environment, probably it should be to the point. Whereas in a family or friendly environment, we will be open.
Mm-hmm.
And we should respect other person's sentiments, etc. while speaking. And it should be to the point.
Great, sir. Since we are talking about building professionalism, so we'll be focusing more on our professional behaviors. And in professional behavior, as you rightly said, three things that you should be focusing on: the environment, the person that you are talking to, one, you should be, and you said you should be I guess I lost my network.
Yeah.
No audible, sir.
You lost your network.
Okay. So, are we back?
Yeah, we are back.
Fine. So, I was talking to Chandra, sir. He said, mentioned a few things. He said that I need to be aware of the person that I'm talking to and be to the point. Am I right, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Anyone else who would like to share his thought as to what is important to him as per to keep in mind in while communicating, and I'm talking about verbal communication out here.
Yes, sir. Our content should be clear.
Absolutely.
The content should be clear. We should speak about the things, whatever may be highlighting. We have to be very clear about the content. That's what my person. If we are very focusing on that, we will do a optimistic communication also.
Very good, ma'am. Thank you so much. Absolutely, you're right. Anyone else would like to share his thought process if it is different?
I think the communication process basically should have some strong intent, and then probably you should know how to connect with people through communication rather than just peripherally communicating. Just make it a little more passion in conveying the message to them properly, whatever way you can. So that way, use communications to connect with people so that you know, you move a little closer and things will be done as you wish and like that.
Oh, great. So you have mentioned three things that I could gather. One is that intent should be there, the clarity should be there, and it should work on building the relationship or positiveness in the communication.
Yeah,
absolutely. Focus on that.
Yes.
Wonderful, wonderful. So ma'am, now we can share the screen. I think we all are on the same page when it comes to the verbal communication aspect that we need to focus on. And as you all rightly said, ma'am also said the same thing, that we should be first clear and concise as to what we are going to talk about. Brevity, they say, na, brevity is the soul of conversation. So it has to be concise, it has to be succinct, it has to be as short as possible, but not taking away the content out of it. And to get into clear and concise conversation, we need to first think as to what we are speaking. Most of the time in our conversation, it happens that we forget to give it a thought as to what we are going to say. That is how our brain, brain functions at a certain speed, and our words coming out of from our mouth function at a different speed. And when there is no match in that, sometimes our conversation becomes more blabbering, irrelevant, or more taking a more longer route to convey the message. So better we spend some time into thinking as to what we are going to speak, how we are going to speak, have a format as to what are the points that are going to put in, and then have that conversation. Third thing that we need to focus on is, instead of giving a negative connotation to the communication that I am having, it is always good to wrap it in a positive conversation. So even if I am talking about certain gaps that I could be seeing or certain problems, so rather than using word problem, it could garbage and challenges, we could say, rather than things that are not working my way. Or so the words that I choose will carry a lot of meaning in the conversation. And way to improve conversation is that post the conversation, do I spend some time in reflecting on the conversation that I've had with the person? Do I give time to analyze what kind of a conversationalist I am being with people around me? And to bring more clarity in the conversation, it is always good to ask questions rather than assuming things and, boarding on a different train to a wrong destination. It's always good to keep asking questions. So before I move on to the next slide, any questions on parts of verbal communication that we have to focus on? No question means you can move on to the next slide. And that is the written communication. And written communication is very simple. We need to follow a ABC format, and which is accurate, brief, and clear. Out here, I like to have spend some time on this, because in corporates, specifically in corporates and in academics also, I have seen at times people do not focus on as to how they are composing the mails. They don't use the tools that are there in the available to them while having an email communication. At times the subject line is not changed, and conversation keeps happening regarding different subjects, but on the same subject line. At times the conversation, the mail that comes to a person, it's difficult to understand as to what is the crux of the conversation. Do you ever have faced these kind of problems in your email conversations? I'm talking about the different communications. If not,
yes, sir.
Yes. You have faced?
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Right. Many times it happens, sir. Because when a person wants to reply, sometimes he replies to all, which is not at all relevant to many, if there are some 100 people in the conversation list. So many times we experience this.
Absolutely. And in times of when we are escalating, I have seen, rather than talking directly to the person that matters, of the easier way of choosing, or maybe by mistake people choose reply to all, and the matter that was between two people suddenly is becomes more like a something on a social media within the premises, known to everyone, and everyone talking about it. So very necessary as to we choose to whom we are replying. Very relevant to choose as to, are we mentioning the subject line correctly, which reflects as to what am I going to talk about. Very important to build a context to it. Sometimes I have also experienced that people miss out on building the context. So the person who has received the mail is suddenly left high and dry understanding as to what is the subject matter that he is talking about. Is he relating to something that has happened today, or is he relating to something that has happened, say maybe 15 days back? Is it something related to his own self, or is it something related to general? I mean, there could be so many things that are not clear. So building the context while writing as to what you are going to mention is important, and then the point, and then there has to be a follow-up also in the next paragraph as to what is your intent of writing that mail. What is the expectation that you have from the person to whom you are sending the mail? Was it just for the information sake? Was it that you look for some action, or was it that you look for a meeting, whatever? So if all these things are taken care of while having a written communication, we definitely come out to be a step ahead in being more, coming out to people as being more professional. Can we move forward, ma'am? And next slide. Okay. Now, since we are in an age of a digital revolution, or something that there's so much of tools that are available, there are so much of mediums that are available in communication, we have to adapt ourselves, have the agility also to be adaptive to these communication styles or the medias. So there is a grammar check, there is a proofread. We need to get into a habit of not just writing and shooting off the mail. There has to be a pause after a mail is written. Read the mail as a third person. See to it whether the tonality of the mail, the words that are written, are being read as the way you want to communicate. There are times when in a hurry or huff of the moment, people write mails which sound differently than what their intention was to a second person or third person who is receiving the mail. So the idea is, it's always good to write a mail, pause for some time, read afresh as to how the entire mail is sounding, what is the connotation that the words are giving, check for any mistakes, grammar or spelling, rethink, is it necessary, is it going to be beneficial, is it required, is it positive, then only send the mail. If it does not qualify on any of these criteria, if it is not important, it is not required, it is not positive, there are other means of communication also. Mail can only escalate things at times which might not be the intention. There is a phone call available, there is a WhatsApp available, there is a face-to-face meeting available. So before shooting, or because once you have sent the mail, you are left with no option. Now it is up to the other person as to how he takes that mail. So we need to apply a check principle when shooting off the mail. Making sense, sir? Ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Right. So ma'am, we can move forward. Non-verbal communication is a subject in itself, but I have just written down some of the points. Out here, rather than me talking about it, I would invite you people, the esteemed faculties, because you all deal with these things in your day-to-day life, and share your views. I have just given bullet points. I am requesting each one of you to please share a thought on two, on the posture, gesture, voice, tone, inflection, timing, eye contact, facial expression, personal space and appearance. Anything you can choose and share your thoughts, please.
This is what I said earlier.
Yes. You took this to be a starting point, but I take this as a midpoint after understanding myself and then aligning and then taking all this thing together. And as you rightly said, all these things come together. That is where we are coming to. So, sir, please share your thoughts on any one of these things that you would want to, or maybe some more than one.
Hello, sir. Yeah, regarding eye contact, it is very important, because I observed that sometimes we will not be seeing students through our eyes. Then there is a disconnect, and they will be in distraction. But when we start seeing their eyes, there is a connect. So that is what is my experience, sir.
Wonderful experience. Thank you for sharing that, Mr. Chandra. You can see how challenging it is for us now having a communication, because we are not having eye to eye contact. The effectiveness, the speed at which we are having a communication or conversation is being hampered, you see, because we are not seeing each other face to face. We are not having eye contact. So I'm not understanding whether the conversation that I'm having is being accepted as the way I want it to be accepted by you all. And that is what the problem you face in your sessions also, or maybe anywhere while talking. If you are not having eye contact, it becomes difficult to understand as to whether the other person is, one, understanding you the way you want, two, are you having a control in the class? Because my eyes, when meet these eyes of the student, they speak. And they have an effect. So eye contact, as very rightly said, is important. Yes, can I have somebody else also pitching in for something? Nashi ma'am, you have switched on your camera. Would you like to put in something?
No, sir, not actually.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Thank you.
See how challenging it is for me to have non-verbal cues and still communicating. I don't
a big challenge.
Okay, let me ask you this way. How many of you are actually aware of the posture that you have while you are taking a session, a class, or having a conversation with somebody that you are meeting for the first time? Professional communication that you are having. How many of you are aware of the posture?
What was the question, please?
I am asking, how many of you are aware of the posture that you are in? The, you know, your body.
Yeah. Sir, sometimes we'll be conscious. Sometimes we'll be conscious. Sometimes probably will not be aware. That is what I feel, but it's very important.
Oh, it is absolutely. Posture is something that makes, you know, the first impression and a very lasting impression. Believe me, just to, you know, support what I am saying, even today when I am taking this session, I am not sitting. You can see I am standing the way if I am visible. But, you know, the way I take a session in classroom, I'm still standing and I've put the laptop on a pedestal where I can talk to you while standing. Reason, when I sit, my posture and my voice tonality and my speed, everything becomes different. I'm not used to it. I am used to in classroom and being aware of my posture, which from where I draw the energy to have a conversation with the people. Similarly, in the classroom, whenever classroom or maybe talking to somebody else, how is that I'm standing? Am I balanced on both the legs? Am I slouching back? Am I, you know, shifting my weight from one leg to the other? Where are my hands? Are they visible? Are they stationary? How is the movement of my head and eyes. All this comes under posture is very, very important because everything reinforces what you are saying. Suppose I am talking of something which is very important, which is very close, and I have a lot of conviction in that, but my body posture is not supporting that. You know, I am talking to a class in sitting down, maybe in a laid back situation, or my posture is looking like as if, you know, I am relaxing. My conviction will not be conveyed to the students. Am I right, Mr. Chandra?
Yes, sir. Absolutely, sir.
So you are absolutely right, sir. Even now, the thing is, if we are comfortably sitting or placed in a particular room, we might feel about confident about switching on our videos. In this particular session, I haven't switched on my video. The reason is I'm not comfortable right now in my wherever I'm sitting right now. So this is an example. So, but whereas in the previous session, I kept my videos on and off in between. But in this session, I have it. So that is a very good example.
Thank you for sharing that, Anuradha. Absolutely. Your posture and the surroundings, they govern your comfort. And since you are not comfortable, that is why you are not sharing. Absolutely correct. And to make yourself comfortable, the moment you are there visible to everyone, you are aware of the posture that you are having, the way people are seeing you.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, moving on to the next point, gestures. Praveenji.
Yeah. Okay, I would like to share only one thing in this regard, because when I heard it for the first time, I was really surprised that a book named An Actor Prepared by Stanislavski,
mm-hmm,
that is being given to all the freshers who join in either Harvard or Stanford. I don't remember the name of the, but certainly top universities of the world.
Mm-hmm.
They are given to them so that they are able to use all these forms of non-verbal communication effectively. They are first to supposed to read that and then to use that in their classrooms.
Great. So that goes on to show the importance of these non-verbal communication clues, how much aware should we be. And talking about gesture, Praveen sir.
Yes, sir.
See, sometimes you might be having this experience in the class also, I don't know. I have had my personal experiences in the sessions when I have asked, have you understood? And you know how the reply has come. Yes, sir. We everything I have understood. Now, how do I take it?
Sir,
getting me? My gesture is telling me that I'm conveying that not understood. It's no. But verbally, I'm saying understanding. So, the person who receives the communication is actually, you know, confused whether the session is going in the right direction or not is a clue out here.
Sir, I think even hand gestures are important. That is what I feel, because even I keep moving my hands during in the class when I'm explaining something. I don't know whether it is correct one or not, but I also keep seeing these anchors moving hands. I think that is very important.
Absolutely. They are very important. If you see, my hand gestures reinforce what I am saying, and they should be in consonance as to time. Are you getting it?
Yes, sir.
Now, the same statement, if I say it this way.
Sir, sorry.
Praveen, you are saying something?
Yeah. This is valid. This is very good when we are into the classrooms and at professional gatherings. But certainly, if it is carried at home, then certainly you will going to get the response.
So you will get a response. What my wife keeps telling me, don't be a trainer at home.
That is what I mean to say. It should be left in the office itself.
Coming back to the conversation that you were having, see what happens in this communication, in this conversation only, when I said, right, I showed my thumbs up, then I used my hands. So what I'm doing is I'm reinforcing what I'm saying and it is aligned. But if my hand gestures are not aligned and I say, yes, yes, what you are saying is absolutely, you know, correct, mind blowing. So my now hand gestures are communicating something differently and my words are different. This will definitely confuse the listener or will not impact that much. The idea is use gestures, but they have to be aligned as to with my pace and the words that I'm using. That is important, sir. Right, Chandra, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, very much, sir.
Fine. Now coming to voice. How important is voice tone and inflection in having a effective communication? And how can we improve in our tonality and inflection?
Like I think it's by practice and experience probably.
Sorry?
By practice and experience, I think to some extent we can improve our voice. And it's, as usual, it's very important, like any other points that you have mentioned.
Yes, yes, sir. It is important. And there are some things that we need to focus on in our voice tonality and inflection. Speed at which the words are coming and are being heard, we have to give time for the people to assimilate that, process that, then only that understanding will come. So there has to be a process when I'm speaking fast. There's a time when I'm intentionally slowed down my speed. There is time which I'll say with a louder voice. There are things where I'll stop, give a pause, meaningful pause. That is all what tonality and inflection talks about. And definitely it has huge, you may call it a drama, you may call it, you know, bringing in some points of dramatics in this, but it has a huge, huge impact in terms of the effectiveness of communication. I have had excellent faculties in my, you know, growing up period who were absolutely great academicians, very knowledgeable. But when it came to passing on that learning to students, because of some of their conversation styles, the message was not coming that effectively and our interest was not being held in the session. And because of that, our learning was impacted. Do you think, this is something that as a faculty, I also need to look in? Yeah, Praveenji.
No, I will not speak now.
I would want input from the people who have not spoken at all in the session. So just to check whether they are actually there or it is only the icon is there.
My posture is, I'm hiding my posture.
No, that is fine. I'm not looking for cameras. I'm looking for the verbal communication. Can I have some verbal communication from the participants in the session? All well or all in well?
Hello. Yeah, very true, sir.
Yes. Yes,
I remember one of my faculty member who taught me. Actually, this statistics paper, he's a very good teacher. I know that he knows in depth about the subject, everything. And I have learned many things about him. And then, but still, I remember the way in which he was he used to take class. He will be more closer to the board and he will be talking to the board, it looks like. So we used to comment on it, but still we know that he has things to deliver, share with us. But I felt that because of that particular character, many of my classmates, they don't feel like learning that subject not listening to his lectures, not coming for his classes, all those things have happened. So it is because of the way in which he was teaching us, because his voice was very, very soft. And then he will not even walk through the class. He will be closer to the board. And he will know, many times he will find it difficult to even face us. I don't know, maybe he's in this early part of his teaching career. Maybe that was the reason. But whatever it is, it really has impacted us.
Thank you so much, Anuradha ma'am, for sharing this, because that reinforces as to where we are going in the right direction, and you know, brings a lot of energy back into me. I'm having a conversation rather than a monologue. Thank you. So now I'll move a little faster on to the other points. We have talked about eye contact. We have talked about the facial expressions also. See, in facial expressions, I'll just talk about one thing. A smile conveys a lot of positive energy. So whenever you are having a conversation, if you can smile in between, believe me, you create a lot of positive vibes around yourself and the people around you. Thank you so much, Praveen ji. And be mindful of the personal spaces that you are with people, because we have to be mindful of that in the present scenario also, as to when we are talking to other gender or we are talking to the same gender, we need to see to it that we don't invade the personal space, that is the personal aura of the person, go too near or to have a conversation whereby, you know, the comfort of space is not there. And lastly, but not least, the appearance, as to how I am appearing in terms of my grooming, my dress. Yeah, ma'am, can I move on to the next slide? Communication don'ts. This is what brings down the professionalism. Stop, delete, absolutely avoid gossip. Anything that is not meaningful, that is negative, that is not required to be shared is gossip. Flirting, though people say healthy flirting is good, all that, but in professional life, in professionalism, flirt is absolute no. It does not reflect good. The topics like politics, religion, or personal problems should never be brought in the discussion at a profession. Complaining about the job, co-workers or supervisors is more like sitting on a judgment, judging other people, which never conveys good about your personality, and it is absolutely non-professional. And coming out as somebody who doesn't care about the respect of other people definitely is not at all being professional. So these are some of the don'ts that I'll harp upon and move on to further. Next slide, ma'am. Self-explanatory. Presentation and appearance. Perception matters. See, this is a matter of debate in a lot of sessions that I've had. Sir, perception, presentation is, you know, appearance is too shallow. It is not important. Important is the knowledge that I carry. But please believe me, the first impression and the longing impression that is created is the appearance. And appearance should be in conformity to the profession. So it could be any profession. If I am in forces and I want people to respect me and, you know, carry that credibility, I need to wear that uniform. If I am into academics, I need to appear to be coming to a college and not just walking in and having a session. I need to be dressed to the occasion. That is what it means. It could be as per the norms and standards that are regulated within the college or university or the workplace. Because at the end of the day, the perception matters. Presentation is equally important as attendance and punctuality. And you are only given a very short time to make first impression. They say a first impression is created in first 3 seconds. Yeah. And may I move to the next slide, please? So the appearance has to be neat and clean, well-groomed, proper hygiene. Since in academics, you don't have a uniform, so that point is not important. Universities, we do not have health and safety standards. That is more for the companies, organizations where production manufacturing happens. The idea is that your appearance is a reflection of the company or the organization that you work for. People don't see Crescent University. People see or understand or draw conclusion from the people who are representing Crescent University. So how you appear to them is the first impression that you are creating about your profession also. Yeah. Next, ma'am, next slide. This I'm sure you all are doing in your profession. I'm talking out here of competence and initiatives. So you all are competent, you all are competent, and that is why you are here in this profession. But point is, are you also taking initiatives? Because when you take initiatives and extra responsibilities to go a mile longer, you reflect the competency to carry a tougher task or maybe more challenging task. And that is what is expected in a professional environment. That is what our stakeholders expect out of us. They do not expect that people to shy away from taking initiatives. They do not expect people to, you know, just be doing the work, just connecting the dotted lines. The expectation of the stakeholders is always, how can we improve upon the existing? And to improve upon the existing, I need to have an intention, an attitude to take initiative. Initiative is an opportunity for me to showcase that I am an expert. I am being accountable. I am taking the responsibility at making a step higher, making it go a step higher. Yeah, ma'am. We can move on. Is there a question on this slide? Initiative is do what needs to be done without being told. Complete all job duties promptly and professionally. Take actions and ownership. And also at the same time, help others or take on extra projects whenever possible. That is how we define you can be seen as taking initiatives. We can talk about in length on this, but I think this is self-explanatory. So with your permission, can I move to the next slide? Okay, important. Effective work habits. Not that all that we have talked about were not effective, but there are certain things that we need to be aware of as to how they are effective. It says that whenever we are having a conversation, or our outlook should always reflect that we are looking for solution. Our conversation should not be problem centric. Ma'am, I have a problem. You see, this is a big problem in our culture. You see, the university is facing this problem. Problem is self-evident. Most of the problems people know. And when you talk about problems and problems, it becomes more of a cribbing. It carries a negative connotation. Where I can contribute is by having my mindset and having a communication which focuses on how can I solve that problem. Is there not even solve? Can I make an effort? Can I contribute? Is my thought process solution centric? Am I looking at solving whatever are the challenges that are existing around me? Because as rightly I mean, there was a portion, a small portion, there was a overlap in the earlier session, and you were talking about the circle of control and circle of influence. If we talk about problems, we are actually enlarging our circle of concern, and we are, you know, shortening our circle of influence. By being proactive, thinking of solution, we are enlarging our circle of influence to a size where our circle of concern would become smaller and smaller in terms of things that are going to stress us. Control the controllables and look forward to having a solution-centric mindset. That is what effective work habits talk of. Okay. Second point, it says mediocrity is enemy of excellence. You keep doing things on an average, just completing the task, just keep doing whatever is required. You are being an average performer, and average performance will never take you to excellence. To be an excellent, you'll have to make an effort, have a mindset of giving more than that you think you can give, achieving more than what you think you can achieve, and helping the organization and people around you to achieve that, move towards that excellence. Effective work habit also talks about doing a thorough follow-up and follow-through. Now, what is the difference between follow-up and follow-through? Sir, ma'am, anyone would like to throw some light on this, please? Difference between follow-up and follow-through.
Simple. This is a test of English. This is a test of English language, I suppose.
No, my intention is not to do that.
Follow-up is basically when you give a task and give some time to complete, and then you take up the, okay, whether it has been complete, to check and verify whether it has been done or in the appropriate spirit or not. And follow through is basically you are hand holding someone to complete the task. You are delivering the task.
Wow, wonderful, Praveen sir. Follow up with people for the work that you have delegated, or the work that you have delegated to yourself, and you would be follow up in terms of going back as to whether how, where you are, how much work is to be done. Whereas follow through is where you take the task to its culmination. Beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing that. You made my work easy. Next point, renounce assumptions. The moment you build conversation or start working on assumptions without asking the right set of questions to people, there is always a risk of creating a lot of misunderstandings, if I can say, creating a lot of hard burns, creating a lot of things that are not conducive to the environment. You are not wrong, but maybe the assumption that you made was slightly different than the reality. So it is always good to ask. Asking might, you know, create a ruffle for a second or two with the person that you are having a conversation. But building the conversation on assumption, mind you, it can take you to an entirely different set of destination, which you might not even aim to. And lastly, effective work habit is also to have a great work-life balance. You should not come out as a workaholic. You should not be extending your work to your home or your home to your work, as we say. It has to have separate compartments. And an efficient, productive professional is one who is able to identify and work in a manner which he is able to enjoy and his family is also able to enjoy. Ma'am, can I move to the last slide, I guess? Next slide, ma'am. Not much. Time management, you all know, and it's been much talked about. The idea is, do we plan, organize, and prioritize? The three takeaways of time management. I have goals to achieve. I have set my things. Do I have a plan in place? Have I organized the resources to do that, to complete that plan? And have I been able to prioritize the things, my tasks, in a manner that are leading to my goal? That is all about time management. You manage your activities around the time. Time cannot be managed. That is the thing. You can move forward, ma'am. Integrity and respect is the foundation of workplace success with managers, co-workers, and customers. So integrity, how do we know that the integrity is being reflected? When do you see integrity in another person?
No financial embezzlements.
Okay.
No copying of the work. Like in academics, we keep taking help from other literatures, and then we should be giving the credit to the due person.
Yes.
That, thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much, Ravindji. Absolutely right when you said being transparent, you are doing, contributing and giving credit to the person from whom you have taken the material, conforming to the guidelines and the standards of the environment, work culture that you are in, following the don'ts, following the do's. That is all about integrity. Yes, ma'am, you are about to say something, Lakshmi, ma'am.
Yes, sir. People with similar thoughts and similar commitments, we can form a community.
Fine.
Integrity fine. Approach.
Yeah, we should have an approach which reflects integrity, which conforms to the standards of the environment that we are in. Okay. It is also reflected when we stay clear of the causes. We don't talk ill about anyone. We don't talk negative. We avoid getting into fights and arguments or conflicts, because as a person, we need to understand that I am also right. The other person can also be right. We have a difference. There could be a difference of opinion, not necessary to be right or wrong. Different is not equivalent to wrong, is the statement that we should carry. Right? Follow the workplace standards, be a source of positivity and encouragement, share credit when deserved, considering consideration for self and others, value of people differences, understanding conflicting point of view. That is all the bullet points that we can cover under integrity and discipline. And we can move forward. 5 minutes before I close, I am trying to, you know, be professional and limit myself to the timelines. Coming back to integrity and respect, how we can build upon this? Here I like to spend some time. Important to know my co-workers. When I'm saying important to know my co-workers, means I need to know even their personality styles, their likings, some of their things that they absolutely don't stand for. I need to know their background as to, so that I can have small conversations. This is all important about from the point of view of having conversation, having a relationship built up. Courtesy is to be reflected in my communication. It has to be respectful. It has to have politeness. It has to have words that show that I'm being respectful to the other person. It is not only necessary that I carry respect in my mind. I need to express it to the other person. Then only I can bargain for respect, being respected. Encourage co-workers to express opinion and ideas. I should be giving free environment as far as possible so that people don't feel stressed out. People don't feel that there is a kind of environment prevailing which could be more like not letting them out with their steam that is pending up. So that is a very difficult situation to handle in later on stages. So it is always good to have an open communication, open conversation, where people can express their views and ideas in the professional manner. Listen to others' viewpoint. Listening is one of the most important aspects of communication, as you all know, asking for advice and help and being honest all the time. So these are what we call respectful work behaviors, because when you show respect, you get respect. You create that environment, you also be a part of that environment. And we can move on to the next slide, please. Important, I feel, in today's environment, in the ever-changing, fast-paced changing environment in life, there are going to be setbacks. My success in building professionalism depends on my ability to build resilience. And the resilience can be termed as something, the ability to recover from or adjust from setbacks and challenges is what we call resilience. There are bound to be some certain pitfalls. There are bound to be times when I might not be as successful in meeting the goal or achieving what I'm intending for. Now, do I sit back and sulk when I fail or I'm not able to achieve what I'm looking for? Or am I resilient enough to get up and start moving again? You know, there is a very beautiful Japanese saying which sums it all. It says, fall down 7 times, get up 8th. Not important how many times you have fallen down. Important is, do you have the courage, the resilience, the grit to stand up again and move on to your path. So in building professionalism also, resilience is going to be an important aspect, because there are going to be times when I would feel that this is good to have a knowledge, but when it comes to application, maybe the challenges would, you know, push me back. There, the resilience would come in play. My grit, my perseverance would come in play. I'll have to refocus, remotivate myself, and get back to applying the learnings. This time I can move on to the next slide, please. Last but not the least, for any profession, in any profession, it is the people around me who help me move further in life. So this is what we call networking and relationship building. You cannot be successful all alone in isolation. Success is built by people around you through your relationship building and networking. For this part, please make efforts. I might be an excellent, specialist, you know, somebody who is top notch knowledgeable, but to be successful in my career as a faculty member, as somebody who is passing on the knowledge and looking at aligning to the goal of the organization, I need to have people around me who are working with me to also be successful. And for that, I need to network. I need to make efforts. I need to take out time for this. At times I say, no, I don't have time for all this. I'm so busy with the article that I'm writing. There's so much of work. There's so much of pending work. Yes, there is. With the work, it is equally important to have emotional bank in people around you. Look for opportunities to build on this network. Provide value to the people around you and when you are having a conversation. At times, you might have not talked to people around you for a lot of time. Reintroduce yourself, check and follow up with those people so that you are always in touch. Give space. Doesn't mean that just keep following, just maintain, focusing on maintaining relationship. The idea is that you should have people around you who on and off you are able to get back to them. Think long term. This is not a short term thought process. Networking is not short term. Relationship building is not short term. It's you never know when somebody is going to be of help to you, when somebody is going to come back to you and help you out, when somebody is going to benefit you, or when you will have an opportunity also to benefit the other person. It goes both ways. It is always a long-term thought process. The golden rule for this is do unto others as you would want them to do to you. And we please move on to the next slide. We should be aware of the consequences of unethical behavior. They are listed. Anyone, if we are lacking as a person, if we are lacking in our professional behaviors, we are unprofessional, unethical, it could lead to incarceration, that is jail. It could lead to job loss. It could lead to loss of professional license. It could be, yes, I'll share the details. I'll share, Praveenji, I'll share my contact details. It could be leading to a limited employment option. Even it could lead to legal fines and fees. You all would be knowing better in plagiarism and all those kind of things happening in the academic era. Loss of respect and trust, definitely. Guilt, depression, anxiety, and damage to the environment as a whole. These are some of the consequences of not being professional or having unethical behavior. Man, next slide. So the roadmap to building professional is, we need to understand that individuals do not become professional because of some sudden leap or jump that they make into the stratosphere. Suddenly they become professional. No, not possible. Individuals become professionals because of their lifetime dedication, commitment to higher standards and ideals, honorable values, and continuous self-improvement. My entire last 2 hours will be a waste if we do not understand this particular slide. The intention of this session was not for knowledge. It's all available everywhere. The idea is, have I been able to make it applicable in your personal life? Would you like to get into becoming a better professional at your workplace? Yeah, with this, ma'am, can I have the next slide, please? Praveen sir, this answers your, these are my links. Thank you all so much for patient hearing. I am open to questions. Dot at one, I am able to wind up. I think been on time, started. Yeah, ma'am. Open to questions.
Discussion. We had.
So to wind up, I would request you all to please share your feedback either on WhatsApp or on my LinkedIn. Would like to hear from you all as to how you found this session. Your constructive feedback is going to help me to improve as a professional. You know, this is important for me also. So please be forthcoming with your feedback. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you,
Akshay. Thank you so much for sparing your valuable time, accepting my invitation. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you as well.